Okay, so on to my talk, which is actually a very different talk than I've been giving at CCS lately. It is actually a more applied talk about network models that we've been using to three data sets of COVID-19 related variables. So to explore relationships in these data sets between mental health variables and also COVID-19 related variables. So it's a bit different. It's not necessarily complexity research per se, but the methods that we develop come from the complexity point of view of psychology. So in that sense, it is related. So first, I will give an introduction to network psychometrics. Then I will talk about three studies that I've been working on in the last year, where we've used these methods to explore relationships in big data sets. And the introduction I'll actually keep really quickly. This is a topic that we actually have an entire summer and winter school on, if you're interested in that. We're also writing a book on, so this is a topic that's quite big and there's quite a lot to say about it. So I'll try to quickly summarize it all in one slide, but that of course doesn't really fully do it justice. But to get to the more interesting analysis, I'll just very quickly summarize it. So the main idea here, and if you've been at our previous sessions, you've probably seen this already as well, is that one thing we've been working on is to develop methods for going from data to network models. And in this case, these network models are networks of variables. So that makes it very different than many networks you see in CCS, like this network here, for example, relates to a variable in the data set. So this could be like, I sleep badly or I don't sleep badly, or I am tired or not tired, or I'm constrained poorly or not constrained poorly. They're not necessarily entities like people, but we're interested in exploring how do these kinds of observed traits relate to each other. And that comes from a more general perspective where usually we used like latent variables for that, like depression causes symptoms. But you can think that these symptoms can also influence each other. Like if I sleep badly, I'm tired, I might be concentrating poorly. And from that perspective alone, we could already explain a lot perhaps of, in that case, clinical psychology but or psychopathology, but also other things like personality and things like that. So that's the perspective we've been going from to try to capture these kinds of relationships in network models. And you can take a very theoretical approach to that, build these things up from theory using dynamical systems modeling things. Jonas will talk about that later as well. I take a more data science exploratory driven approach where we really try to discover relationships from data. So we have data. In this case, our data looks really like this. Like we have multiple subjects and they're meshed on multiple items, and those we try to translate to network nodes. And the edge then relate to some sort of description of how these two nodes relate to each other. Now, this has been a big topic. I wrote my dissertation about this, but so did many others in our group. And you can read these if you want to know more about that. And the main type of models that we've been using are these so-called pairwise marker random fields. So this is an example of a network that you can get. And here, all these nodes represent, in this case, personality traits. They represent like, I like to go to parties, or I like to have friends, or I am angry easily. I think this one is like, I'm easily angry or easily irritated, something like that. And these links here represent, in this case, partial correlations. So these are positive for blue effects and negative for red links. And the links indicate the strength of conditional association after controlling for everything else in the network. So let's say this link here between N3 and N2 represents the strength of association, how strongly are these things correlated. It's not always a partial correlation. It could be a different parameter per se, but it's like you can interpret it like that after controlling on everything else in the network. So taking into account everything else that we have in the model, how stronger these things still correlated. That's the general idea behind these models. And there are some nice reasons to do that. I don't really want to go in too much detail, because then I would be talking for half an hour. But some main reasons to do that is, one thing I like is that you can see what I call predictive pathways. So if you see here, like E3, for example, it's connected to like A2 and O1. And this E stands for like extroversion, A for agreeables, O for openness for experience. It doesn't matter that much. We could see here that if we would use a multiple regression model, AE3 would be predicted by A3 and O1. But we can also see that A3 would be predicted by E3, but not by O1 per se. But because O1 predicts A3, O1 predicts E3, and that in turn predicts A3, you can get a predictive pathway, if you will. Like here we have a prediction effect, here we can predict that. And that can be very insightful to see. Because normally if you do a regression and you only take like A3 and you regress on all other variables, you don't get these pathways per se, you only get like direct effects. Another nice properties about these models is that they're very closely related to causal models. And that means that if you have a underlying causal model like A, B, C, then that would lead to the undirected network as well, like this. Then you have the problem that you might have some equivalent models, like you have like A, B, C, for example, that would be the same indirect model. So if you have an edge here, like you can't really take a causal interpretation because the direction might be unknown. And there are some cases as well in which you do get edges in this network where there is no link if there is an underlying causal model. So I don't like to take a very strong causal interpretation here. And also if you do that, people will write commentaries on you and stuff. But there is a nice link between these two worlds as well. And that doesn't mean that you can also take sort of hypothesis generating approach here with, okay, this link, it might mean something or not. Estimation, well, we can do a lot. Mainly you can think of, okay, let's see, these are, we can remove everything that's not significant, for example. Like for example here, there's no edge, right? So that might have been an effect that's not significant, or we can use like some regularization technique to pull these to zero. And then only remain or are left over with the edges that are substantial enough to have enough evidence for that they're not zero. There are many ways to do this. You have also model selection tools, but I don't really talk about this in detail. Many of these are conservative. That means that they try to only include an edge if there's a lot of evidence for it. And they don't try to not include edges if there's not a lot of evidence for. Well, that's a brief summary. If you want to learn more about this, then we have summer school, winter school. We're going to have one in January again. We also have a lot of papers about that. I'll have some references as well in the end of the slides. All right, so the first data analysis that I want to show is this work that I did together with Dong Liu and Adela Isvaranu. And this is a very interesting data set. We were approached by Dong Liu in April. And he had a data set of 675 COVID-19 patients from Wuhan, China, from the first outbreak, after hospitalization. So they were measured like a month after hospitalization on several things, like their what they did in the hospital, but also underlying medical diseases and also residual COVID-19 symptoms, so symptoms like a month later after hospitalization. And other things, and also mental health variables like depression symptoms, anxiety symptoms, post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms. That was very interesting, especially at that time. So we helped explore these data sets with networks. We just had like, okay, we collect a lot of data, so it might be interesting to look at what's happening there. So we used some network models there. We wrote a preprint, we submitted a few times, got rejected a few times. Now the data is not as novel as it was then, perhaps, but I think these results are still actually very nice and interpretable as well. Main thing that we did is we used mixed graphical models, which is a type of Markov vector field that can handle both continuous and binary variables in this case. And that's because the treatment options here were binary, like ICU admission. Like yes, you were in ICU, or no, you were not in ICU. That's not a continuous variable. So we used this MGM package from Jonas Hasselbeck, who's going to present next, actually. Probably not about MGM, but we used that as a regularization technique, and then we used that together with EBC model selection with gamma is 0.05, if you know what that means, or 0.5, you know what that means, and it's nice. If not, then you can forget about it. We also did a directed acyclic graph analysis, because there were some variables, especially like the COVID-19 variables and the treatment variables, that we thought can are quite plausibly related in a causal way to each other. And there we explored it using these more really causal analysis approaches. We used the BNLearn package for that. There were some missing data, so we used mice imputation. If you want to know more, you can read the preprint on that. And more importantly, the data is open, right? So you can play around with the data as well. So these are the network models that we got. There are three network models that are this indirect networks, where actually we have the same variable sometimes, and then we have different psychiatric symptoms. So these are like the anxiety symptoms, but here there are PTSD symptoms, for example. And then we have the DAC, and I'll first talk a bit about these undirected network models. So where one thing that I found very interesting myself was that they all showed something as a similar pattern, and that is that you have this COVID-19 severity. So this is how severe was your hospitalization of these patients, right? How severe was the COVID-19 during hospitalization? And that was actually completely disconnected from the residual COVID-19 symptoms, which in all networks, they are the same variables. So you wouldn't, that's not really a replication or anything. But it is interesting to see that. So they're all disconnected. They have only have indirect connections. So they have connections via the mental health problems and the cortisol steroids treatment. Right. So you have this cough disorder steroids here, here as well. Here you don't, but you have, these are the same variables actually, but you have more more variables, so you have less power, so you could have just not detected it as, for example. But that I thought was very interesting, that there was a significant correlation between these COVID-19 severity and some residual correlations as symptoms, but yeah, not strong enough to really lead to any direct edges here as well. So that's indicates that people that had like a very severe outbreak in the hospital are not necessarily the ones that also have very severe symptoms a month later still, which I thought was interesting. I'm not a medical expert myself, but so I'll just leave it at interesting. Anxiety network. Now here we have some bootstraps that we always do on the side as well to see if the network was stable. I won't talk about that here. These look pretty okay, actually, better than we see often. So this network seems quite good. Ideally, you also look at how these networks look like if you bootstrap and stuff, but I'll skip that for time here. So these are the anxiety symptoms. And here there's not that much interesting happening. One thing that's interesting is that this COVID-19 is related to some of these anxiety symptoms directly. Now, these are very weak edges. It could be that if you have a new sample, you would get other symptoms connecting to it. But it was interesting to see that there were links between having severe outbreaks and anxiety symptoms afterwards, which I thought made sense as well, but it's also interesting to see that. And actually, we got this in all three networks. We got links between COVID-19 symptoms and psychiatric symptoms, severity and psychiatric symptoms as well, which does mean that these are correlated at least. So I would not necessarily say that the relaxed and nerves are these super important symptoms here. It could be that it's connected to other symptoms as well that we missed out on. But it is interesting to see that there are links between the severity and the symptoms. Now, in the depression network, we have the same. So in this case, COVID-19 severity is linked to energy and anhedonia. Anhedonia is like this inability to feel any pleasure or to be happy, I think. What I found most interesting in this network actually is the rule of suicidal thought. So what I find interesting here is that you have these negative links, right? These are negative links. Now, usually negative links, when you see them in a system like this, so the interesting thing here is that all symptoms here mean like more is worse, right? All nodes actually, like ICU, if you go into the ICU, that's worse, right? And severity, more is worse. And also symptoms, more is worse. So you kind of expect only positive relationships between all these variables. So if you have negative relationships, then you are looking for some explanations for that. The main explanation usually, if there is some sort of common effect structure, like if you have an underlying structure like this, then you would induce a negative edge here. But that can't be the case here because there are no clear other variables that these two are linked to. So fatigue and suicidal thought are not linked to a third variable. So that definitely cannot be an explanation here. So what's actually interesting here is that both these negative links are in line with the literature on suicidality. So one thing, it is disputed, and it's not like not everybody agrees with it, but one thing you do see in the literature a lot is that people with very high levels of fatigue they are like too fatigued to even contemplate committing suicide, for example. And that's actually a risk of antidepressants that discuss sometimes, that it alleviates this low energy, very high fatigue first before alleviating any other problems. And then actually people get more suicidal thought, even though you are trying to treat their depression. So that has some grounds in depression and suicidality research. And then this one here also has that, because many people that have suicidal thoughts, they do that because they feel like the world is a better place without them, perhaps, like their family is better off without them. But if your family is sick and you need to take care of them, that is not like less the case, of course, for people to believe. So that actually makes sense that people would have a negative or less suicidal thoughts when there's an infection in the family, perhaps. I thought it was interesting. PTSD symptoms, again, COVID-19 severity being connected to some of these symptoms. Actually, difficulty sleeping, it's connected to so many of these residual symptoms as well, that perhaps it's also just a COVID-19 symptom. My camera's losing focus, but that will probably go better. One thing I found interesting here as well is that family infection here was negatively linked also to reckless behavior. Which might have a similar interpretation as the suicidal link there. Like people that have sick people in the family might become less reckless because they might have to take care of people. Okay, lastly on this study, the DAGs, the directed acyclic graphs, and these I found extremely nice results. So what you see here is that this is the estimated network, and these are bootstrap samples that are basically like how often did an edge appear if you would bootstrap the data. And one thing that was nice here, that we did not blacklist any edges, or we didn't whitelist any edges, so we did not add an edge by default, but we did blacklist edges. So we said like, yeah, for example, age cannot be caused by anything else. So that means that all these edges here, they are discovered by the algorithm that we used. And the main thing that I like here is that all these edges actually make a lot of sense as well. Right, so here we see, for example, that age leads to higher education. Well, if you're older, you can have finish your university. Age leads to underlying disease. Well, yeah, we know that. Older people have more underlying diseases. Underlying disease leads to more COVID severity. Yeah, that's obvious. If you have a higher outbreak, you're going to be treated. So you either go to the ICU or you get steroids. If you're in the ICU, you get a mechanical ventilator. Men smoke more than women, for example. Like all these things made perfect sense. If you're older, you can get married more often, right? Or you're more chance you're already married. So it's not necessarily that we found anything groundbreaking here that will change the way that we treat COVID, but it's nice to see that these DAGs can lead to meaningful relationships that do make sense here. The only thing here is that here we didn't find any direct edges, but we also kind of did not expect them to be. So we could also have not included them. All right. Second study I'll talk about briefly is the study that we are doing together with Alexander Mansvedo and Jorijn Koelen, and also Reinhard Wiers and Finneman. And this is a nice study because it's a data set that was administered last year. So 808 students that were already administered in 2019. And then the study was set up to be administered again in April. And then it was when the whole world started burning. So they have measures of a lot of things before COVID and also during the first lockdown, really at the height of that. So like a lot of things like anxiety, depression, things like that. And some things were only measured before, some things were only measured after. Like, for example, how do you deal with COVID-19? We don't have a pre-measure of that, of course. And we did the same analysis here, but then we used a slightly lower gamma parameter and the rest is all the same. So the network looks like this. We played around a bit trying to include different variables and stuff. So in the paper, we'll be a bit more detailed about that. But mainly we saw some things that were quite similar in all these results. These are all change variables. So this means the change between before and during the COVID-19 outbreak. All right, so the main thing that connected these to the other variables, like these green ones are the stuff you could influence, for example, are stress during and emotional support during, right? So COVID stress during linked to loneliness linked to anxiety and depression. And that was quite a strong link that just emerged a lot. And this stress during or emotional support during linked to loneliness. So people changed less in their loneliness if they had more emotional support. Makes sense a lot, I would say. There are some very weak red edges here from physical activity. They didn't show up that much in the bootstrap. So we want to be a bit more careful interpreting these as well. Now, one thing that we found interesting as well is that change in alcohol use wasn't related to anything. And that was actually the stuff we were interested in this study. So that was a quite interesting finding. And there's some demographic things here that are also interesting, like international students having more maladaptive coping strategies, for example. Okay, now for time's sake, I'll go over this third study a bit faster. It's also a bit more complicated study, but this study is quite nice as well because it's from Eikenfried. And he set up to do a time series analysis to follow 80 students, 2 weeks of time, 4 times per day. And he set it up exactly when the COVID-19 lockdown period started in the Netherlands, which was basically like right here. And that was by accident, right? But it was a nice nice co-occurrence. So this is a time series data. And then you can do something else. You can do like these time series models called vector autoregressive models. In this case, we use a multi-level variant of that. And you can get insight in basically the same network structure I showed you before, but then has a more within person interpretation, but also in the how variables relate to each other over time. So how does one variable predict variables at the next time point, 3 hours later? All right, so there's like a lot of stuff measured here, like I found it difficult relaxing, I felt irritable, things like that. And also some behavioral variables, like I was social offline, or social online, I was outdoors, I was home, things like that. And then if you look at this data, you'll see that there are quite some cyclic patterns that make sense, right? These are just the days, these are nights, so people are like home at night, right? Especially when all the bars and restaurants are closed, you're home. So we had to detrend that using a regression on the block of time in the day to make sure that we weren't modeling this kind of noise. And then the resulting network looked like this. So you get a network where you have relationships within the same measurement and relationships over time as well. Now here, there are some links here that are just very straightforward. So like, for example, if you're home, you're not outdoors. And if you are worrying with COVID-19, you're also occupied about it. So that is not really that groundbreaking, but it shows that the model is detecting relationship that it should be detecting. So that is good news. One thing I found here very interesting is this: these variables here, where we have this alone variable predicting over time, so 3 hours later, that people would be worried about COVID-19. Predicting 3 hours later, people would be occupied about COVID-19. And that actually predicted also. This one is linked to quite a lot of these mental problems over time. So people that were occupied a lot more than their average in one time block were on average had more stress problems 3 hours later, which is an interesting finding here. Other than that, all these mental problems being related to each other is not that surprising. That's why we are doing this. So most stuff is, yeah, it's nice to see that these models actually pick up stuff that kind of makes sense. And that's, I think, the general conclusion also for all these models. I'm way over time. I have one more minute, so I skip the acknowledgements. There are some websites you can look at if you have more, want to know more. Facebook community is very cool. Please join that. Thanks a lot to Urban Mental Health. Urban Mental Health is a big center we have. And at the end of the session, Reinhard and Claude will talk about this. Usually, we are in this beautiful Institute for Advanced Study in Amsterdam, except now we are just on Zoom. All right, that's it for my presentation. Thank you for your attention.